Today we're going to be talking about a story by the world-famous R.L. Stine. That's right. I'm of course talking about none other than When Good Ghouls Go Bad. Our movie opens with a young boy named Danny as he tries to adjust to his new life in his family's ancestral town. We're told this by Christopher Lloyd mumbling his way through the opening narration.
Walker Falls, Minnesota was about as far from normal as you can get without a transporter room.
Danny is picked on by everyone, and I do mean everyone, in the entire town, and I have no idea why. It's so bad that even the flag football team opts for tackling the poor kid instead of just grabbing his flags. How is it that even I know that's not how the game is supposed to work? One of his new tormentors, who I'm simply gonna call not Griff Tannen, pulls him aside so he can tell the story of a troubled young man named Curtis Danko. Which is about as poser a name as you could get. I mean, at least have the good sense to put the word dark into your name. Preferably with two K's. Anyway, this proto-Edward Scissorhands was the weird kid who was shunned by his classmates, and it's obvious that that was exactly what he was going for here. It's completely fine if you want to hide your work from the public's eye until its grand reveal, but come on, dude. Did you really need to wrap chains around it? You're trying way too hard to be the weird kid. Please look at me so I can leer back at you condescendingly. While working late on one of his projects, which he can do since, of course, middle school children can use campus facilities this late at night, he meets his horrible fate after getting locked in the kiln.
When he opened the door and looked inside, all that was left was Curtis Danko's burned-up skeleton. His completed sculpture, and a message written in his own ashes. If you ever have another Halloween, I will return and destroy you all.
After that grim warning, the people of Walker Falls have never even so much as mentioned Halloween again. And in all fairness, they probably should be afraid of something like that. Not because of some goth kid who kills himself and writes a message in his own ashes, that's just stupid, but because there's some nutball out there who's got a serious hate on for Halloween, and he's willing to kill over it. Apparently, Curtis's sculpture was imbued with evil, or something, and it almost blinded not Griff's father, not Biff. So naturally, something like that would be buried in Curtis's crypt instead of putting it away in some evidence locker or having it destroyed. Not Griff tries to shove Danny inside the crypt, but he escapes thanks to this stupid little talent of his.
And as it turned out, there were actually some advantages to being built like a scarecrow.
Maybe so, but I'm pretty sure that phasing through things isn't one of them. The bullies chase Danny back into his house, where we meet his Uncle Fred, played by Christopher Lloyd reprising his role of Mr. Clipboard from Food Fight.
Uncle Fred?
Survival of the fittest, Leonard!
Why does he call himself Uncle Fred instead of Grandpa, since he's the father of Danny's father? I have no idea. Maybe he's his dad's brother, too.
Everyone, even my own family members, call me Uncle Fred in public to keep the human symbol of the Walker Chocolate Company front and center at all times.
My God, does he sound bored with his script? Just get in, get out, get paid, then on to the next cinematic embarrassment. I know that I said in an early review that any actor will tell you that work is work, but Christopher Lloyd? Fire your agent! It doesn't matter that the bullies didn't get to torture Danny with the statue, because Nunt Griff has other plans for it.
What are you gonna do with that?
We're gonna get rich with it.
How?
How much would you pay to see what's under the shroud?
Nothing.
And how much would you pay to not see what's under it?
So what? You're just gonna drag that thing all over town and threaten people that you're gonna flash it at them? I'm sorry, but there's a pretty easy way to get around that. See? 'Cause I don't. After a brief interlude where Uncle Fred dresses up like some kind of weird ringmaster and Danny dresses like Matt Smith,
I wear a fez now. Fezzes are cool.
He and his family go to a meeting to discuss the town's financial troubles. We get an awkward exchange between Dad and his old girlfriend, and he goes on stage so he can- STOP! Okay, seriously? What the hell? In the span of what can only be a couple of hours, we see this guy dressed as a Viking, some kind of circus performer, and now he's a woman? What kind of sick mind is constantly playing dress-up like this? Why isn't he locked up? Anyway, Dad here explains that he can save the town if he can get a bunch of German investors to invest in his family's old chocolate factory, who he'll be wooing with a Halloween spooktacular on October 31st. If the idea is to revitalize the town's economy and rekindle its love for Halloween, wouldn't it be a better idea to... oh, I don't know. Try to do it before Halloween? What, do you expect to get all the investments you need and produce all the candy that you need within a matter of hours for people to buy the candy from you before trick-or-treating that night? After that bit of fail, we cut to the next day where apparently the entire town is covered with Halloween decorations. This is... actually pretty creepy. Submitted for your approval, a town with no taste for ghosts and goblins suddenly finds itself covered in the trappings of Halloween. This particular All Hallows Eve that has been thrust upon them without warning will leave them with a very special treat. It will demand that they go from one doorbell to another until they find what they've really been trick-or-treating for. And they will find it only in the Twilight Zone. Of course, the entire town is drawn to this massive pile of pumpkins sitting in town square. Grandpa Uncle Fred pulls one out of the pile, and...
oops.
Well, what the hell did you think was gonna happen? Honestly! By the way, a pile of pumpkins would not just topple over like that. Unless something pushed it from the top. Something which might want Uncle Fred to join its otherworldly ranks. After Grandpa Uncle Fred's funeral, which everyone in town was attending, Danny meets a pretty young girl named Dana who consoles him in his time of need.
You start thinking about all that gross stuff that's happening to their bodies. Down there.
Well, it took us half an hour to get there. But we have our ghoul, ladies and gentlemen! Seriously, what the f*** is up with this girl? Someone you love dies, and that's the first thing you think of? I never thought of that!
It's like a miracle in reverse. The cells breaking down, the flesh disintegrating. Everything dissolving away.
No! No! Stop the tender music! This isn't a sweet, heartwarming moment! This is terrifying! And a miracle in reverse? What's so comforting about thinking of that?
Aren't you a cheerleader?
Don't ever smile like that again! She takes Danny to Curtis's abandoned home, which she refurbished herself into a haunted house.
So where'd you get all this stuff?
People's attics, basements.
She's a kleptomaniac as well. Charming.
All summer long, kids have been sneaking out after dark to help me build this. And saving up all the candy their parents give them, so we can trick-or-treat in here.
Okay. As a concept, that's actually a pretty sweet one. They're scrounging up candy all throughout the year and salvaging whatever Halloween decorations they can find, all for the sake of putting up a real haunted house so that the kids of the town can have a real Halloween. Except that it's coming from this girl, making it creepy as all hell!
If you don't get to survive being scared as a kid, how are you ever going to survive being scared as an adult?
I have a better question. Why isn't this role being played by Christopher Lloyd? An old man remembers what Halloween is really all about and wants the youth of today to have fun and benefit from having a real Halloween? That makes sense. But you? Who are you?
And there's so much more to be scared of.
I know! We're looking at her! Not Griff suddenly shows up and demands that he be given access to the top room of the house for his statue extortion scheme. Dana refuses, but Danny caves and complies to his threat because Griff's father, who is a mayoral candidate, can shut down the chocolate factory if Griff says to.
That was close.
Yeah, close to the most cowardly thing I ever saw.
Oh, you mean like how you stood by and did nothing while he was getting picked on at that football game? Pot, meet kettle. Danny goes back home to discover that, OMG, Grandpa Uncle Fred is alive! It's a miracle! In reverse. Of course, Danny is terrified by this. Fred has no idea how this happened, but we don't have time to ponder over any of that. Time to go terrorize a town who's already traumatized by all things Halloween-y.
Something wrong with your jaw muscles. Ouch!
They're usually in such good shape.
You're dead!
You're right!
Our world beyond this world, Cackle! Times beyond this time!
As you'll soon find out!
Get away from me!
Anybody else want a piece of me?
Oh yeah, this'll do wonders for their anti-Halloween sentiment. By the way, you'll notice that he's a lot more lively now than when he was alive. Was the idea that the sweet release of death is a blessing in disguise? If that's what they were going for, wouldn't it make more sense if they made him sickly and bedridden? With the way he was always dressing up and playing with toys, it looked like he was enjoying his autumn years just fine. Being freed from the shackles of life doesn't seem to really change much. Danny finds Dana at the haunted house to tell her about his uncle, but her mom shows up and wait a minute! His dad's old girlfriend is her mom?! Oh, hi, Luke and Leia. How's your sex life? Anyway, she tracked her down by following the obvious extension cord running from their house.
I just followed the fuse that leads from here all the way to the $600 bomb we got in the mail today from the electric company.
You can either pay for this bill out of your allowance for the next 370 years...
Hold it! $600 being paid off in 370 years? You give your daughter an allowance of 14 cents a month? You're a bitch! She takes Dana and Danny to some kind of birthday party, auction, Oktoberfest, political rally thingy? Where the hell are we? There are a bunch of other kids in attendance who are expecting John Wayne Gacy to entertain them. And his car is apparently full of beer cans. This is a clown that we can trust!
Excuse me, Mr. Cheesy.
What?
How much are they paying you to do this party?
A lot more money than you have, given this guy's incredible reputation.
Where is that stupid clown?
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you your nightmare fuel for the next couple of weeks. Take a good long look, people. First of all, this isn't Cheesy's costume. Where did he get that monstrosity? Second, this is the face of pure evil. It looks like he's gonna eat your soul. What did he do to Cheesy?
Hi, kids.
Hi, Cheesy.
Who wants to see some magic?
I'm gonna make this pencil disappear.
Put it there, pal.
Look at that, she doesn't even flinch at Danny's freaking out. I guess being a Time Lord will do that to you.
My magic hand has disappeared, and I need it back. If I'm going to hand you this $100 bill, whoever finds a magic hand gets the dough. Whoever finds a magic hand gets the dough.
The creepy hell clown? put his hand down his pants and says that the first kid to get it out gets $100. Must be a Bob show! I mean, my God! This isn't a good ghoul going bad, it's a creepy ghoul going horrible! But Danny and Dana, whose names are disturbingly similar, don't want to deal with this pedophilic rampage anymore and take him away in one of the musicians' boxes that they apparently won't miss.
Hey, just where do you two think you're headed?
Are you up to something with that disassembled clown? You are so grounded. They go back to Denny's place and start piecing him back together.
Oh, yeah.
Dana is creeped out by drilling his body parts back together. You lost all your creeped out points right after we met you. But then a bunch of other zombies start walking around and chanting.
Lick all feet, smell my feet, give me something good to eat.
Then we get Grandpa Uncle Fred's bullcrap explanation about why this is all happening.
Remember all those millions of fireflies we tried to catch this summer? And how one day, when it started to turn cold, they just didn't come back? What do you think happened to them?
They died, I guess.
Remember how that weird kid from down the block used to smash him and rub the glow stuff all over his face like war paint? And it still glowed even after the fireflies were all mushed up. Why do you think that happens?
Just a chemical reaction in the air.
No, Danny. It's magic. And when all those millions of fireflies die, their bodies come undone and release their magic into the ground. And it just collects down there, waiting for someone to use it. But to do that, you need to wish harder than you ever wished for anything. To still be here, with the people you love.
Or the people you hate. If Uncle Fred can wish himself back, why couldn't Curtis Danko?
Okay, let's just say for the sake of argument that fireflies actually do have magic inside their bodies. And whenever they die, all that magic just goes down into the ground. And if somebody wants their dead loved one to come back to life, all that needs to happen is for them to just wish for it. Even supposing that, we never saw Danny actually wish for Grandpa Uncle Fred to come back to life. It's kind of implied that Fred wished for himself to come back to life. Are you telling me that nobody before now ever thought to themselves, gee, this sure does suck, I wish that I could come back to life, hey, wait a minute! And that still doesn't explain where these other zombies came from. Who wished them back to life?
Hi, son.
And we see Dana's mom act exactly the same as Danny's father when he sees his dad come back from the grave. Is Grandpa Uncle Fred her dad too? What the hell is going on in this family?
Run for your lives! They're everywhere! They're putting up Halloween decorations!
What do they want?
To put up Halloween decorations. He literally just said that. While Grandpa Uncle Fred holds off the other zombies, the kids are off to hold off Curtis because the magic will fade away eventually because firefly goop, I think? Okay, I'll believe that you were buried in that suit, but if you were buried in that top hat, I'd wager you'd be nothing but a skeleton by now. And you? What are you wearing? Did you lose a bet in life? Did someone bury you in that getup as a joke? Or are you the Indian from the Village People? YMCA. The kids get to the haunted house because I have no idea. And on their way through the cemetery to get to the haunted house, they see Grandma Grandpa Uncle Fred acting as some kind of zombie dispatcher.
All units, the citizens of Walker Falls have all been accounted for, except for Dana Stenson and my grandson, Danny Walker.
You see, it's funny because dead? They get to the house, where a couple of fireflies, magical creatures they apparently are, possess one of the kids. Yes, it's none other than the King of Pop! No, this is Curtis Danko himself. And he looks like every other drawing made by Tim Burton. He and the zombies bring his statue downstairs, when all of a sudden... Presenting the secret origin of NFL Super Pro! Of course, Curtis can't be taken down by brute force, and he reveals the statue to the crowd. It is a sight so horrible, so shocking, so unbelievably WHAT?! Are you kidding me?! This movie has been building up this statue as a thing of nightmares that will scar your very soul. And it's just Grandpa Uncle Fred?! Oh, just wait till you hear this. This is beautiful.
It's an accident, I swear.
You were there?
Just a prank! We didn't know the kiln would get turned on!
You saw the statue when you went in the kiln the next day. That it was pure evil. You told everyone that it was too horrifying to look at.
How can I let anyone see that I was wrong all along about Curtis Danko?
So you wrote the curse in the ashes. You came out pretending that your eyes were burning. You convinced everyone that Curtis was pure evil, and you took away Halloween for 20 years?
That's right! This was all an elaborate hoax to cover not Biff's ass. And that's all well and good, but how the hell are the zombies walking around if there's no curse?! Were the fireflies just really bored this Halloween?! The movie finally comes to an end as Fred and his dead wife, who was never established before now, are reunited. Not Biff is dragged away by his zombie father to a fate unknown. The town's faith in Halloween is restored, I guess? And the zombies all dance away into the night.
Would you, I mean, could you ever see yourself
dancing again?
Hypothetically speaking,
I think we better keep those two a few blocks apart, at least for the next few years. After all, we have all the time in the world.
No, you don't, Aunt Mom! You're surrounded by dead people! They're a grim reminder of your fleeting mortality! If you're gleaning anything from them dancing around, it's that you should be taking advantage of every moment that you can! Idiot! So that was When Good Ghouls Go Bad. Does it work? No! If this movie was placed in more competent hands, this could actually make for a decent story. But the plot's all over the place, the special effects are crap, the actors are terrible, the magic fireflies thing is confusing and stupid, and Christopher Lloyd was completely wasted in this. Although there is one good thing that came out of this. I'm now feeling so much pain that I'm gonna write some depressing poetry about it. Later.
You start thinking about all that gross stuff that's happening to their bodies down there.